Welcome back. Well, yes, keeping focused on assessing where we are at the moment. What do we do? How do we ensure we get things right post-COVID? We've got Mr. Peter Obi joining us this morning, former vice presidential candidate of the PDP and former governor of Anambra State. Good morning, sir, and thank you for joining us today on the program. There's this announcement.
Good morning, Mr. Chamberlain.
Yes, thank you. The government, they say, is now become necessary for us to have extended this lockdown by 2 more weeks, as it were now. So that we all have got to grapple with in Lagos, Ogun State, and the FCT. Now, what is your impression or assessment of how we are approaching this fight holistically now?
Well, Mr. Chamberlain, let me start by thanking you for inviting me and thanking all of you at Channel for the great work you're doing in this fight against this pandemic. Yeah. And I also thank the frontline heroes, the doctors, the nurses, all the healthcare workers who are risking their life even without a clear insurance that we are in fighting it. And also thank the federal government of Nigeria and all the state governments who are doing what I consider a very good work and all that. For me, the extension of 2 weeks is necessary and important. It is necessary and important. Why so? Because we don't have the resources to fight this pandemic if it escalates or spreads. So the only thing we have now is containment and everything. But in doing so, it is critical that we look at two things, ways in which we can manage this process more effectively, and that I mean by testing, being able to test more, because right now our testing process is very low compared to our peers, even in Africa. And then again, trying to give appropriate stimulus to those who have reached the limit of their sacrifice, because you can't quarantine hunger. You need to do something. So these are the two areas I think, while we're still trying to figure out what to do in other areas, we need to deal with decisively.
Okay.
And we need to move with this.
All right. We'll come back and let you shed some more light on how you suggest we approach this, particularly when you say the hunger component is indeed a huge factor. Stay with us. Welcome back. Well, Ms. Obi, when you say that we can't quarantine hunger, it does appear as though it is in that same breath that the government also did announce, while announcing the extension, that we now have to increase the social register from 2.6 million to 3.6 million households in 2 weeks to ensure that they cater for at least additional people. Perhaps they may do so moving forward. Is that in any way, what kind of impact do you think that will make?
Well, Mr. Chamberlain, I think we're missing up two things completely. What the federal government is doing now is the issue of conditional cash transfer. We're not talking about cash transfer. Cash transfer was designed solely by Professor Magnus Bacall, whom Obasanjo brought back from the US then, and he looked at a model in Brazil and Mexico, what they used to pay all mothers so their children can go to school. So they were being given stipend over a period in order to enable them, because they couldn't allow their children to go to school because they have to go and do menial jobs and everything. So because they were paying them fee, they allowed their children to go to school. So that was what conditional cash transfer is all about. And that has captured about almost 11 million Nigerians. But because government could not afford to pay that large number, they reduced the number that they were paying. And that is what we are talking. But when you talk about COVID-19 problem and what is the occasion in unemployment, You have to look at the figures that are all over the place. Before this scenario, I can give you an example with other countries and I come to our own. Let me tell you, let me use the US for example. US had an unemployment of 5.5 million people that are unemployed. With this crisis, they now have 17.5. UK had 1,560,000. Today they have 6.6. So you could see about 3-4 times. In Indonesia, it used to be about 6.2 million. Now they have almost 12 point something million. In our own case, the number of eligible people that are supposed to be working is 91 million. Only about 50, 51 is employed. So we have 40 million unemployed people. This is from Nigerian statistics before this crisis. So now with this crisis, let me not say it has doubled, but the number must have gone up reasonably. Coupled that we are said to have had 98 million people living under poverty. So these are people we should tackle. Conditional cash transfer, what you give women for their children to go to school. So even if you add 1 million, okay, assuming that 2, 3.6 million is included in this, you know, people who are not affected, if you minus it from 40 million, you have about 36 point something million to cater for. Chamberlain, the ones I'm talking, let me give you an example where we have a crisis and the ones I'm talking. If you go along every area of Lagos where you live, or you go out from here, let's say you're traveling to the east, you come to Ore, you come to Benin, Chamberlain, there's people who go out every day with 10,000 naira, they buy 40 pieces of bread. It's sold to 250 naira each, and they sell it 300. At the end of the day, when they sell out 40 pieces, it comes to 12,000. From that 12,000, they've made 2,000. That is where they will take maybe 500, 600 to eat for the day, get some money to pay rent, all this and all that. When you do lockdown, because it's not only these three states that are locked down now, the entire country is locked down. When you do lockdown, these people are not earning anything, and that their 10,000 capital is not what they're eating or living with, which has exhausted. You can go on a wheelbarrow person. If you buy today in Lagos, or let's say in Onitsha, it will cost you 10,000 naira to buy the China wheelbarrow, 12,000 naira to buy the Nigerian one. If you buy it and you are carrying load and you do 10 trips a day, you earn about 2,000, 2,005. You pay government your 100 naira daily because government tax you every day. And then you pay the market where you operate another 100 naira. So you go home with 2,000. These people live off their daily income. If you are traveling to Enugu, there's a place we call Ninth Mile and Ubolafo. You have people who sell what we call Oba. If the woman has come to Oba, he buys a quantity, he spends about, he says about 50 raps or 100 raps a day. Those who sell 50 raps told me it costs them about 3,008 to buy it. They sell 100 naira and they get about 1,000. So they make 1,002 a day. Those who sell 100 make about 2,000 something. These are the people that will have crisis. And all over the place, I can see the letters for Canada people and all this. What are we going to do to them? And there's models that have been done everywhere.
Before you talk about those models, models, now we know that, hang on a minute, I hope you can hear me. Now, those figures, combination of several factors, including, but many of these people, I mean, all of them live in states. And we also do know that states have a huge role. They are a huge component in the scheme of things, and the lockdown is not in every part of the country. Yes, the government is, they've announced several measures, the CBN themselves too, equally announcing so many measures, and then we have different corporations trying to also wade in and do what they can. But taking a look at it from the perspective of states, how? Because do states, are they doing enough creating that kind of environment to also and also ensure that these persons who are unemployed in their own states are catered for? From your perspective.
Chamberlain, this is a war situation. You don't have a war situation and you're telling components of the state. That's why I said earlier that the management of this process is not working. This is a federal government fight because it's an essential problem. It's a national issue. You cannot tell each component of the state when we are at a war to go and start buying their own ammunition, I mean their own troops and everything. That is why we exist as a country. India have states. But what they did is to look at the Indian poor masses and everything and decide as an initial stage that they are going to bring 1% of their GDP, $27 billion, which are going to be used for food and direct cash transfer to the poor. You says will only work with you as a component. Even in America, you hear every day saying they need this, they need this, they need this, they need this from federal government. We are not talking about issue that have to do with maybe Lagos, Anambra, or this or this. Look at what I was just said about this, what I talked about this. Today, you can see people are telling you that we don't have enough this to test this, to do that. There's nothing that stops Nigeria from having testing centers in every state of the federation. There's no state that we don't have a university teaching hospital. We're not trying to build a nuclear plant. This is a testing lab. What a sophisticated thing. This is something that can be set up within 1 week, functional. And we have the capacity. If you go for Anambra, for example, they tell you they're going to do testing in Ebony or in Benin. We have a teaching hospital in Awka that is functional.
Much as we get your point, but even in some of those other countries that you mentioned, you also do remember that, yes, they need those key materials from their federal government, but their states are equally bringing a lot to the table. But back here, when you talk about us setting up labs, I mean, the NCDC has said as much, and perhaps we'll also get them to also speak a lot further, because it can never be too much information. As long as people get the right thing, ultimately, that should be the aim. But it's not just about setting up these centers. We also have to talk about those facilities, the test kits, and then the personnel. So, are you factoring all of those when you say we can set this up within a week?
Chamberlain, test kits are all over and available. Let's not do all these things. People are doing whatever is possible to get all these things globally. It is not a rocket science. We have a way we can ramp up this and do it better. We have a situation where, for example, South Africa, you can say they have a better facility, but they've tested 80,000, out of which they have only 2,000 plus. If you look at this, it's just 2.5% of the people that tested. In Ghana, they've tested almost 38,000, and they have only about 566, which is about 1.5. In our own case, actually, we just tested about 6,000, and we have about 300 and something, which is about 5%. So if you do it, if you look at it, test and result in terms of being positive, ours is actually higher. So we need to do more aggressive testing, because this is what will give people confidence that we're on the right path and everything. NCDC, all the people involved, don't get me wrong, are doing a great work, but we need to move with speed. Just like the same thing I'm saying, we need to cut out for more people that are with this, they have reached the limit of their sacrifice. They can no longer sacrifice anything again.
Just one moment. You,
Just one moment. You heard my colleague Chemlin was asking you about the role that the states themselves are supposed to play in this fight. You said it's a war and everyone agrees, but the components are quite variable. There is the health component and there is the economic component, which you also mentioned the other time, that we can't quarantine hunger. So while there is quarantine, you know, on the one hand of, you know, cases that have been tested positive or that are symptomatic, there is also that part where the states ought to be able to do something. So at this point, yes, granted, you said it, a number of them are doing quite, you know, fantastic work at this moment. But what are those things that you expect that the states, 20 of them at this moment, are supposed to be doing now, which they may not be doing? And what kind of collaboration do you think that the federal and the state governments should be having at this point to ramp up activity so this thing can end as soon as possible?
Okay, thank you very much. Where are you? Let me start where the federal government will be involved. In the sense of setting up maybe testing centers and issue of isolation centers, I expect what they will done, for me, my own humble suggestion, is that initial stage, at a time when they gave Lagos State maybe 10 billion and gave Abuja 5 billion, every state would have been given to 2 billion each. We know what it means to set up a test center and isolation center. So we have a standardized isolation center and test centers, all kitted and everything, so that if, like I said before, if you require to have testing in Anambra State, you can go to either the three hospitals in Nawka or Nnewi. If you go to Enugu, they have the University of Nigeria Teaching Hospital, and they have Enugu State Teaching Hospital. So these things can be wrapped up, and in each of all the city hospitals, we can also set up isolation centers that are well equipped with standard equipment that can take off if the need be, because this is something that we need to move with speed. When I talk about issue of hunger and everything, I'm giving you a clear example. To say that people should stay at home, we are not talking about the people that are paying for conditional counseling. It's a different thing. These are women they need to encourage for their children to go to school. We are talking about those who, because of this pandemic, can no longer go out every morning to earn a living. And don't think they are only in these three states that we have extended this thing. It is all over the country. So we look at it. How many people do I have that is unemployed? Where are these numbers? How are we going to partner with states to say, okay, we are going to, we expect that you have this number of people who are going to be within this, and this is how we are going to be able to do a direct cash transfer to them in terms that they receive, no matter how little the money is. You know,
I'd like us to do something briefly. I'd like you to help us get a view briefly, because we get a lot of feedback from our viewers, and a lot of them can't understand why, you know, the government cannot just say, you know what, we're going to pay 100 million Nigerians a certain amount, you know, per month during this period. You have been in government. If you can give us a perspective of how easy or hard it is for a government to just say, you know what, we're going to give out this amount of money. Help us understand the considerations the government has to make, because so far we've not seen that kind of decision. So how hard is it?
Let me tell you, it's not a rocket science. It's easy for Nigerian government to decide today, because like I said, it's a war situation. We are going to, let's take 30 or 40 million as a number. We are going to pay them for the next 2 months, 10,000 naira each. That's 400 billion a month. And we'll do it for 2 months. It's 800 billion. Everybody will say, oh, it's too much. No, it's not. If you take today, I said it before, our GDP is $400 billion. Every country I know in this world that is have packaged stimulus have spent at least 1% of their GDP. And 1% of our GDP is not going to collapse this country. That I can tell you. We are trying to borrow 20-something billion to be able to do infrastructure, this and this. People have to, the most important infrastructure is that people are alive and they're living. Thereby, if we can borrow 22-point-something billion to be able to do roads, do this, do that, and everything, which is critical and important, we should be able to get $4 billion equivalent. If you multiply $4 billion, which is 1% of our GDP, it will give you 1.6 trillion. And if you say, listen, we are going to use this strictly to deal with this particular stimulus of fighting those who have reached, remember what I said, limit of their sacrifice. They've reached the limit. We're going to use it. We are going to pay them this amount for the next 2 months because this thing will last more than that. And in the third month, we are going to use maybe another 400 to kickstart their business because what you're giving them now is money to eat. Maybe you're going to do another round of sharing of 10,000 for the man who goes every month to buy bread and come out and sell to live. And these are critical. It is not a rocket science.
But Mr. Obi, should we just restrict it to the government sharing those monies to those amounts of people? Or should we add the fact that, let's take a look at what key areas do these spends actually go? If we say, okay, well, we see other countries, well, look at the area of water, electricity. Banks too, all those charges that the banks do have. So if those agencies also intervene in those areas, that will go a long way, don't you think?
It will go a long way, but Chamberlain, let's be serious. Don't talk about water. Where is the water? Let's not go about things that are not available. You know, I see people arguing about the electricity, that they are going to make electricity free, they are going to make water free. That's for people who are like me and you. The people I'm talking don't even know, they've never seen water before, so don't go and start telling them about things so they don't exist. You see, when we who are in government, especially politicians like me talk, we talk as if what we cost, some of the things are brought about French Revolution, where people are talking as if they are not even part of the country.
You know,
people don't know anything about water.
There's also one key thing. There's one key thing about all of these spends, because the money has got to be there for this to happen. But we'll talk about that when we come back in a moment. Stay with us. Welcome back. We're winding down now. But Mr. B, the government has said, the world over, recession is a big deal as we speak. And the government, they say, look, if this continues in the next 3 months, well, it will be very tough for us. So in that context, if they say, look, the funds is a huge challenge, where do you suggest that they will get the monies to do this? Or do you think the money is there and we can afford to do all that you suggested?
Well, Chairman, I agree with you that it's going to be a tough one. I wish we had an opportunity of discussing going forward. But you cannot talk about anything now except the survival and healthness of your people. Like they said, health is wealth. You have to be alive first before you can talk about the next. Recession is going to be a global thing. But what we need to do now in a war situation is to save our people's life and make sure that the poor and vulnerable within us live for tomorrow, because these are our assets. Don't forget that these are our assets. And we need to protect these assets. And we need to do whatever it takes to protect it. If I listen, the last time I listened to the Minister of Finance talking, he was talking about even how they're going to get money from Sovereign Wealth Fund to be able to cover and maintain enough level of money they're going to share to the federal government and state in June. But We have people who are going to die in April if we don't deal with them. So let's, wherever we can, mobilize the resources. And I don't think it's too much with it. Mobilize the resources. We need to mobilize it to be able to deal with this situation, because it's a critical situation. And I can tell you, again, even going forward with what you're talking, I don't think all this has shown is that we now have to look back, you know, apologize for our mistakes of not saving yesterday, and be able to build our country like every other person is doing.
Okay, it is Mr. B, it's a very fine place to let it go. We do sincerely appreciate your time and your thoughts this morning. Thank you very much indeed for talking to us. That's Mr. Peter B, former vice presidential candidate of the PDP and also former governor of Anambra State. So this is, I suggest this can be referred to, you know what they call in the National Assembly, matters of urgent national importance. This is one of such.
Yeah, and a lot of people wonder when the National Assembly would have that emergency sitting just to take a look at this and ensure that we move fast. If that economic stimulus bill has not even been signed into law, and this is over 2 weeks now, I mean, you wonder, what are we really doing?
And you know, as basic as water is, clearly, you know, all of those targets that we have about people having running water in their houses, you can see there's still a mirage. It's still very far from many homes. Having, you know, governments run water rather than, you know, those boreholes that we... But we'll get the point. We do thank you all for your comments and for letting us be a part of your day today. We'll be back here again tomorrow. So thank you all for watching. I'm Chamberlain Oso.
I'm Kaede Okikiolu.
I'm Ayo Makine. Please stay safe.
And I'm Maope Ogunyusuf.